This reminds me several times every day to be really upset about this situation, because this is how we get our water, right?
Our brushing teeth, we fill up a cup and dip our toothbrushes in there to brush our teeth. You're supposed to take showers with the windows open and not take hot showers, because the steam is what gets in your system.
I'm a real camel. I love water. I drink a lot of water. And drinking a lot of this polluted, this tainted water, as my wife calls it.
You know, we like the location, like, you know, being here in North Bennington. It's been a great place to live, but for the problem with not having a safe source of drinking water, which is a significant problem.
In a lot of ways, it's just a beautiful, stunning little country village. It has an adorable town center, really picturesque. I talk about the history of North Bennington. It's very historic. Two governors lived there. It was the site of a lot of industry historically, some good, some bad.
Certainly knew, I knew what Chemfab manufactured there, but you know, as far as the types of chemicals and the processes that they used, I really wasn't aware of that.
With our machinery, we actually would dip it in Teflon, then it'd go up into a tower, then there'd be like big metal rolls, and it would go over maybe 10 foot span, then go down the other side and roll up. Your first set of ovens are like maybe 350, then you eventually get up to 680, 700, and then that would completely dry it.
They would bring the Teflon in here. We had the corporate offices upstairs, and the bottom building was all Teflon storage.
The Teflon's like skim milk, and like I always remember putting your arms in it to scoop it out, and you just, I never really thought it would bother you. That's, you go, just, to me it was just common sense. You wash your arms and stuff off after you're done. Your legs supplied rags, you wipe, you know, wipe dry and stuff. You, if you had, like, say a person just got done handling Teflon, didn't pay attention to it, didn't wash his hands, and then like he smoked a cigarette and he got like even a little drop. What happened is when that hit the ash from the cigarette, gets up over 1200 degrees, and that actually you're inhaling now burnt Teflon, you get cold chills, headache, and you're sick for a day.
My aunt lives actually just over the field here, and I used to run and play through the woods on this property. Even as a child, just knew about the pollutions and stuff that some places could get off, but it was like a dirty plastic smell. That's how I could describe it. I used to watch the news with my dad and stuff, so I was aware that it was probably more than likely the factory.
You could see people across the other side of the mill. You could see them from their knees down. You knew somebody was over there, but you didn't know who it was. It would be that smoky.
Times of the day, I understand, you know, the airborne emissions were so bad that, you know, people couldn't be outside. You know, it was just awful.
They had these big machines, they called them abaters, and they had catalytic squares in them, or like almost like a catalytic converter. Then they had another flame that actually would try to burn the smoke after it comes through the converter, I think. And then it would go up the smokestacks after it's been technically burnt. Every once in a while you could smell it, because the smokestacks would come right up this way, but mostly went towards Royal Street. We did run a lot of the crap at night, so you couldn't see it. And the neighbors complained, they shut the windows and stuff at night.
There's a tremendous amount of PFOA in the shallow soils in our region, and we're trying to sort of try to quantify that a little bit and get a sense of what the trajectory of that might be. We're also trying to get a sense of how far from the plant PFOA traveled, and so trying to track out and see if we can sort of get a good sense of how, once it's released in the stacks from the plants, how far it traveled in the air.
It had already been identified in Hoosick Falls, and I thought, well, the proximity to Hoosick Falls and Vermont is, you know, it's the border community. Is there any way that things could have gotten into our sediment, into our rocks, into our water? And I remember being called out of a meeting because the test had come back positive at very high levels.
All of a sudden, there were two guys at the door. You know, I let them in. The guy says, I'm Richard Spicer, or something like that. And he says, I'm from the state of Vermont. Can we test your well? And I said, sure. And I hadn't heard anything about the PFOA. And I was not ever concerned about it because it was like I was never told anything about it could hurt you or nothing. They actually called us the day that results came in. They didn't want anybody else to tell us or hear about it. And the well was contaminated. So it was like, I was sort of shocked.
This notice that PFOA was in people's water raised a lot of questions. It wasn't clear what the dimensions of the problem were. Very soon after, the EPA was brought in, and the EPA very quickly defined the problem quite forcefully and said, this is a real concern, this is above our health advisory level. The best of our science shows that there could be negative health impacts.
This wasn't a situation where water had just become contaminated. We knew right away. If water was contaminated, it had been contaminated for a long, long time.
Turned out that the well here is a very good well. It's a real pumper. So I began to think naively that with such a deep well and so forth like that, that maybe we would be okay. March 16th, 2016, we're attaching the results of the recent sampling of your drinking water well. I was flabbergasted to find that our well is above the Vermont Health Advisory of 20 parts per trillion. Ours was 438 parts per trillion. And I thought, for God's sakes, how could that be?
It's been a huge challenge for the community. It's a really complicated problem. Nobody would wish upon themselves. That certainly people have to sort of deal with. It's a problem that there's no immediate solution to. I mean, there are good ways of managing the problem. There doesn't seem to be a really clear way to solve it. Getting the PFOA out of the environment seems an almost impossible task. So the question is, how do we manage that presence and how do we minimize human exposure to it?
Right away, we got a 5-gallon water cooler. Then they come up 10 days later and put in a filtration system. We got one of the first filtration systems in North Bennington. Two big carbon filters, and inline filters, ultraviolet lights.
You know, we've been living out of jugs of water for a year and a half, and we just as soon get past that period as soon as possible.
Everybody talks about the water pressure problem. You're pushing water through this whole system and through all these filters and everything. So, you know, if somebody's taking a shower and somebody turns on the washing machine or decides to wash the dishes, the pressure in the shower just like cuts in half.
Every once in a while you forget because you know, you're always drinking like water out of the faucet, but I'll drink a glass. It don't taste any different. We got the blood tests. Thank goodness everybody in the family, their blood was not bad. My blood was in the 400 range, it's like, which is like really high.
PFOA blood test results. Higher concentrations of PFOA in drinking water, the higher level that you are likely to have in your blood. So if you're living here and you have a drinking water well, you know damn well that you're going to have higher levels in your blood.
Well, you're not very happy, I tell you that. and you're concerned because you don't know. I mean, the stuff's in your body and there's nothing you can do about it. You know, it's not like you can put a siphon in your body and like suck it out. It's there until, you know, in, you know, decades, you know, or the rest of your life.
My water got tested and they let me know everything, and then light bulbs started going off because I was having issues, my kids were having issues, and it all just seemed to connect to that. I was losing a lot of hair. I lost weight and just felt like I had no energy. And I went to my doctor. They did a routine blood workup, and that's how they found that my thyroid was really high. So they found that out, and usually if you have a thyroid issue, they can usually trace it back to your family members because it usually runs in families. None of my family has it. My daughters were having stomach aches, missing school all the time, and ever since we stopped drinking the water, their stomach aches are gone.
One learns pretty quickly that little is really known. And in terms of the medical side of things, there's a real difference between causality on the one hand and association on the other. Am I more at risk? I'd say I probably am more at risk, but is it causing something? I don't know, and I don't think anybody can answer that question.
We're to the age now, like I'm almost 70, we're thinking about like downsizing. It's like kids are all gone. Go to sell the house and you got a contaminated well. So your house value has gone way down.
I mean, you know, we have a well that's worth nothing. You know, that's 580 feet deep. The PFOAs in the soil, when it rains, you know, just moves the contaminant right down into the groundwater. Our properties throughout this area are contaminated. I mean, we have polluted land. You know, even if our water supply gets taken care of, the soil is still polluted, and it will be for decades, if not hundreds of years.
We have worked and passed legislation to hold contaminators responsible for when they contaminate. That is really a first step. We want to make certain that those who have polluted, not only in Bennington, but throughout the state, are held responsible, and held responsible financially for making communities whole again. And making communities whole means hooking them up to municipal water.
That's the solution. That will be to make everybody whole again. And I think at a certain point, the stigma that I know is associated with being here because of that I think will then slowly dissipate.
We've been living like this for a year and a half, and it's going to be at least another year. We don't want it to be 3 years, 5 years, 6 years.
I can't imagine having to every day on your mind worry about drinking water and water that you're bathing in, and then your children are drinking it. Even now, worrying about it and thinking about it and having it hanging over your head, no matter what, people will be made whole in this community.
I think it's pretty basic that people have safe water to drink. People don't live very long without water.